Okay, so you're able to see my screen. Huh. So any questions before I move forward? Any questions? No. So if there are no questions, I will go forward. So last time in the lab, I had asked you to sort of come up with a model that incorporates, harvesting. Okay. So we sort of began with the assumption that the baseline model is a logistic model. Okay. Now, on top of that, I told you there are harvesters, and I gave you some conditions on how to go about this. And then you all came up with various models. Okay. So I was talking to all of you, and I figured out what you were all broadly trying to do. So what broadly you were all trying to do was include an additional mortality term, H, here. Now, this H itself could depend on the population size. This was one way of doing, and of course, this H itself could depend on the number of harvesters themselves, right? You know, number of, let's call them P, okay? So this is how it could depend on the number of, individuals in the in this population N, and then the number of harvesters, is not them by P. This is a broad formalism you all thought of. And then you came up with different models. Some of you came up with scenarios where this P was ignored. Okay. We only, worried about the dynamics of N without worrying about the dynamics of P. Whereas in some cases, we also accounted for the dynamics of P. Okay. Now, when do you do what is, of course, a very interesting question, not something very important to keep in mind while you decide to model this. Okay. So as long as you have given reasonable arguments for your choice, it's totally fine. So what we will do today is the scenario where we are going to ignore the evolving or dynamically changing population of the harvesters themselves. Okay. So that's what the focus you're going to have. And we had, there was also a small interesting discussion with one group who were trying to sort of think of differences between harvesters and predators. Okay. One way to possibly think about, but it's not necessarily a very tight definition. You know, harvesters are often in some sense can be thought of as external to the ecosystem, whereas predators are internal to the ecosystem. Okay. So for example, at least the examples I gave you, if they are fishermen who are trying to harvest a fish population, those are sort of external to the aquatic ecosystem. Likewise, if they are cattle, sheep, basically livestock, that are sort of grazing on grasslands and in the forest areas, then they are again harvesters, right? And again, it sort of, is external to the ecosystem, external in a loose sense, in a strict sense, humans and everything that humans control are also part of the ecosystems, okay? But, under some conditions, it might be useful to think of one population as an intrinsic population and the rest of them as external factors. So one way to distinguish them, harvesters and predators, are who is internal and who is external. If it's an entirely internal system, of course, you do need to account for the dynamics of the population who is harvesting as well. Okay, so that's one way to think about it. And we can also, can think, when can we ignore the dynamics of predators themselves. So another, even if it is internal to the system, and one reason why that might be reasonable to do is, when there are large number of prey populations available, okay, then, that's one, you know, one reason to sort of say, you know, I am interested in this population. Predators have so many other populations to depend on that of this prey population is not going to affect the dynamics of that predator population. Predator numbers are, you know, uninfluenced by n and n themselves. Therefore, there is no need to write a coupled dynamical equation between the prey population and the predators. Okay, so that's another reason why we can ignore the p dependence here. So let's now think of, you know, how could this depend on n? Okay, what are the possible functional forms? Okay, and in the lab last week there were few forms that everybody came up with. So I'm going to sort of summarize them. I'm going to summarize them more in a graphical way rather than a mathematical way. So let's say x-axis is n. Now, one simple possible way is that the harvesting rate just does not depend on n at all. It's always a constant. Now, that's one possibility. There's a constant rate of extraction. Okay, that's one possibility. Now, the second possibility is that, you know, that sort of naturally comes out if you think about the validity of this. Now, many of you argued that, yes, you know, the constant extraction rate, harvesting rate might be true, but it's very unrealistic when n is a very small number. And when it's a very small number, if you are still extracting at a constant rate, what's going to happen? You will end up with negative population sizes of n. And therefore, that doesn't really make sense. So the harvesting necessarily has to come down. And how much should it become when n is equal? Let's say if n was zero, what is the maximum possible harvesting rate then? It's actually just it actually will be zero, right? So this assumption is sort of unrealistic. So one has to actually think of, if I were to keep this constant, necessarily has to sort of eventually come down to zero in some functional form when n hits zero. Okay. Now, another way of thinking about this is, you know, what is the per capita harvesting rate? In other words, if you think of, let's define H, which is H divided by N. So what this means is that from the perspective of this an individual in this population, what is the chance of death? What is the mortality rate because of this harvesting? So this is at the level of individuals, right? So one way to think about this is, you know, every individual has equal chance of dying, and that doesn't depend on N. That's one way to think about it. Okay, now the case, then this could be a constant function. Right? So this could be a constant function. So do you see the difference between being constant function for the overall harvesting rate versus the per capita harvesting rate? So let's call the H of N as overall harvesting rate, whereas this would be now, this is always a very useful way of thinking, and you know, let's call the first, you know, blue line here as the zeroth model, okay, and let's call this as first model. And let's call the green one here as a third model. Okay. Sorry, second model. Okay. So now let's now draw per capita harvesting rate for zero. What will you find? What will that be? It's basically a constant divided by n, right? What will a constant divided by n look like? It's actually 1 over n. That would look like something like this. Is that right? It's, you know, zero equivalent, but in the per capita harvesting rate. So this you see, you know, is, you know, it sort of clearly exposes what's the problem with the zeroth model here. The constant overall harvesting rate actually leads to infinitely large per capita harvesting rate for small population sizes. Okay. That's why, as I mentioned last time, it's always useful to draw both of these curves, and that really nicely captures what might be wrong with what. So now let's do the reverse of this. Now we have drawn one here, right? What if we draw one in the overall harvesting rate? So for one is basically a case of constant per capita harvesting rate. How would that translate with the overall harvesting rate? That would just be a constant times n. It would be a linear function. Okay. So unfortunately, I have not been very consistent with colors. So it's sticking to the blue color. So the one basically will look like this. Is that right? Let me make the zero red here. Okay. Now we haven't drawn this two. So two was motivated by modification of zero, right? So how does that translate in the context of per capita harvesting rate? So you have a case where here you start with very small or zero total overall harvesting. It increases, it then saturates, right? The saturating part would necessarily mean that the per capita would be very small, right? When n is large, so it would be a function of, you know. But what about the initial parts?
It would be a straight line or something close to a straight line. Almost constant h.
It's a constant h that just decays. Is this what you're thinking? Something like this? Like this? Is that what you're saying?
Initially for some part straight line, and then it'll decay
When you say straight line, do you mean what kind of? There are so many straight lines, though. You know, this kind of a straight line, or you know, this kind of a straight line.
Be horizontal at the point where the. On that exact same x-axis coordinate.
Okay, so
parallel it begin like a constant. Yes.
And at that point, onwards, it's a straight line. Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm very bad talking here again. But I think you got the point, right?
Yeah.
Is that fine? Okay. So was there any model that does not fall into these three categories, by the way, that any of you came up with?
We didn't write this down, but we did discuss a model in which this H, N, comma P term is inside the logistic term. So 1 minus N minus H, N, comma P by K.
Oh, it's okay. Okay. That is same as saying that H has a prefactor of N, right? In some sense, what you're saying is that you're modeling your H basically is the per capita H, small h.
Yes, but we are including this value in the carrying capacity term as well. So R into N minus H N comma P into 1 minus N minus H N comma P by K.
Okay. So I will take a look at that, you know, what exactly you have done. Maybe that does look a bit different the way you have. So if it was
we didn't write that down. We mentioned it, but we didn't discuss that.
Oh, we didn't actually. Okay, fine. We mentioned it as a possibility.
Yeah, we just discussed it while doing it, but we thought we'll go with a simpler one.
Okay. So there are these three models, you know, are we all fine with this now? So, you know, it's always very helpful to think of what this all means, right? Does it all make sense? So it sort of, you know, if you plot both the overall rates and the per capita rates, okay, you sort of, you know, you're usually able to disentangle all the underlying assumptions you made. It clearly shows that zero is a very bad model, right? You know, you can't really have an increasing death rate as the population size goes down. That's a very, you know, unrealistic assumption, right? Of course, it can increase, but, you know, it can't increase to sort of, you know, in a diverging fashion. For example, even 2, you do have an increasing rate as you go towards lower population, but it actually saturates to a finite value. Okay. And okay, so shall we now go ahead and analyze some of these models? Okay, so let us sort of agree that 0 is a sort of, you know, pathological case, and therefore let us not analyze 0. Okay, let's analyze the case 1. Okay, case 1 corresponds to constant per capita harvesting rate. Is that right? So which means that H of n is equal to sum H times n. Okay, now it's useful. I think, you know, you have all done a fairly good job of describing all the underlying assumptions. You know, what does this mean? Okay. So I won't really go into those. So one assumption this would entail is that the constant per capita harvesting rate means that as the, for whatever reasons, if n keeps on increasing, that means that there is a proportionately larger amount of, you know, extraction or harvesting that is happening. Now, remember that that has its own limitation, you know, it has a, in terms of realistic sum, you know, for imagine a case with where there's a constant or a, you know, or a maximum number of harvesters, okay? If there are maximum number of harvesters, then this will not be, then this sort of, you know, this is not very realistic. For large, so as long as we're aware of this caveat, we can sort of move forward and understand what can happen. So let's now go back to analyze.
I'm not sure I'm clear with the caveat, because isn't this realistic, like how overfishing happens in our oceans right now? Mm-hmm. How exactly is this unrealistic? Because I imagine, like, you know, if there was fishes high, we just over exploit the thing. So I'm just trying to figure out, like, is it not a realistic model? Like, you know, we have finite harvest. Mm-hmm. And if there is more fishes in the population, therefore higher density, we harvest more. We don't, like, oh, the fishes will get depleted. We don't do that humanitarian mm-hmm. thing. So I'm just trying to understand, like, which part of it is unrealistic. That's the part I was unclear of.
Yeah. So, you know, I mean, it might be useful to, if it's, it might be a bit difficult to apply this to a very global context. Let's think of, you know, there is, let's say, you know, large lake. Okay. And there are, let's say, some, you know, the surroundingly there, let's say there are n, you know, some k number of fishermen, okay? And then let's say each of them has a maximum harvesting capacity. All of them are reasonable, right? There are a finite number of maximum capacity, right? You know,
yeah.
And then, you know, and that means that a large, they will be limited by how much they will eventually extract, right? So let's say there are 10, each can harvest only 100 fish a day, very arbitrary number, sorry. Then they can't harvest, they're not going to harvest more than 10,000 per day, just because there are, you know, million fish around them. Does it make sense?
I see where you're coming from. The way I'm imagining is, I'm assuming a very naive model that, you know, fishes are uniformly distributed in the lake or in the pool. Mm-hmm. So therefore, if there is more fish in that pool, that means the density of fishes are higher because geometry. And therefore, mm-hmm. when they fish, even with the same fishing effort, like 1 hour of fishing per day or whatever finite number, then they'll end up catching more fish in their nets, not because of extra effort, because the fishes are more dense. I know this is unrealistic in that aspect that they're not uniformly distributed. So I'm just imagining on that sense, like, therefore, I don't, if the population is higher, so density is higher. If density is higher, they end up catching more.
For the that's same how effort, I they will it. Catch up. Is, that's
exactly, for the same effort. For the same
for
effort.
For the same yes. effort, they will always end up catching
yeah.
more.
Yeah, yeah. That's they're not. They're not catching one fish at a time. They're trawling or doing some net fishing. So it's yeah. a function of density and not by one fish at a time. If it's one fish at a time, I completely agree with you. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah, I mean, so it does depend on some of these details. You're right, you know, but, you know, each trawl also has a maximum capacity.
Just yeah, because yeah I get it. I get it. Okay. Yeah, it will saturate at some point.
And also, the I mean, you know, also, there also be sort of, you know, some relationship between the fish numbers and the density you observe also. Many of them don't really scale linearly across all these parameters.
Basically. Fair enough, fair so, enough.
But, you know, one can have to sort of, you know, think through the kind of scenarios you are thinking, which is very right.
Okay. Fair enough. Get the
okay.
point.
Okay. So now let's analyze this. So this will now lead us to a fairly simple modification to the logistic growth model. Minus HN. Is that right? So this is the new harvesting model. Okay.
We're not accounting for harvester population here, right? We're just saying absolutely harvester no. population size, and this is not
yeah, realistic. We assume that harvesters somehow magically have a constant per capita extraction ability.
Okay.
You know, for every increase in
all the harvesters together.
Yeah, all the harvesters put together, we assume that they proportionately increase the total catch as the N increases. That's assumption. Okay. In other words, every fish has equal likelihood of death here. So it's sort of, you know, the assumption that, I think Pawan, right? You know, Pawan was saying, which is that, you know, harvesters put the same effort, just because the density has now increased, they will have more catch now. Okay. This will be true within some limits. Okay. So let's, how do we go about analyzing? Always remember, try to do rescaling. How many parameters do we have? Think of how many parameters do we have. We have 1, 2, 3 parameters. Okay. R, K, and H. Remember, even in the logistic model, we were able to reduce from 2 to 1. Now, how many can we realistically reduce here? So we can do the same strategy we adopted for the logistic model. We sort of think of N by K as a density. Okay. With respect to the carrying capacity of the ecosystem, if you do this, and you can now simplify this entire equation. So if wherever you see x, replace that by x times k, and what you will find is that now the left hand side becomes d times xk equals rxk 1 minus x, because n by k is x, and then you have h x k. Is that fine? Now you see that k is hanging around in each place, so therefore I can cancel them all, and that leads me to a simplified equation, which is dx by dt is equal to rx times 1 minus x minus hx. Is it fine? Any questions? Can I move to the next page? So how many parameters do we have now? We now have 2 parameters instead of 3 in the previous equation. Okay, let us work with this equation. Oh, I don't know. This is happening every time. Oh, I'm using a different computer last Friday as well as today. And something really strange about this. But I can't even erase this, right? Maybe I'll go to the next page. Oh, it's there also. It's there everywhere.
Maybe you should go out and come.
Huh? Any suggestions how to deal with this problem?
Exit and enter again.
For screen sharing.
Yeah.
This is not a, this doesn't look like a screen sharing problem. It looks like a, this one.
It seems
problem.
Like a feature where, you know, if you want to have
a, it's a bug. It's hardly a, it's a bug. It's not a feature. I mean, you know.
Depends on it.
Yeah.
Can you check page one as well? Like
this. Oh, yeah. Somehow something happened. Somehow we decided to write on every page. Huh?
Can you rub it in the source page? Yeah. Like, can you erase it in the source page?
I can't. Oh, okay. It's going somewhat reluctantly. No, it's not going.
Maybe save and reopen one note.
Oh, it's somehow it's there in the first page. Okay. Okay, anyway, I will now hopefully write it. It's fine now. I hope it's not coming on every page. Okay, no. Okay. So now how do we do? What do we, how do we analyze? We again look for equilibrium and instability. But you know, always let us you know, remember to plot, and plotting can be very, very helpful. So on the y-axis, let us plot the growth function. So we have basically now two growth functions. One is the logistic growth function and the harvesting mortality function. Okay, let's plot both of them one by one. So what is the harvesting what does the logistic growth function look like? It's this. Is that right? X into 1 minus x, or x into 1 minus x. This is how it looks like. What about the hx? Okay, so hx is basically a linear function, right? So let's say h is a very small number. Then how will the hx look like? It looks something like this. Is that right? And when we plot this way, what corresponds to equilibrium? So let's call this. Okay. So what corresponds to equilibrium? When Lx, the logistic growth, equal to the harvesting mortality, right? Which means the intersection of these two will correspond to equilibrium. What are those? There are two intersection points, one at zero, the other one at this point. Okay, so what is, so let's circle both of them. Do it here. Okay, I will do it at a place corresponding to wherever this intersection is happening. Okay, so you can already see one thing that has happened in the logistic model. The equilibrium was at one, that equilibrium has now reduced. Okay, you can ask the now same question, is this a stable method, right? So now let's look at the zero first, which is an easier case to look at. So zero, near zero, if I make a perturbation, what happens to this perturbation? This is a perturbation I have made. What is the logistic growth here? It's this value. What is the mortality here? Lower value. Basically, at this perturbation that I have made, the logistic growth is more than the net positive growth. So therefore, there will be a flow away from zero. Do you all agree with that? Okay. And likewise, this continues throughout. Okay. So therefore, any perturbation I make from zero will flow away from zero. Now let us look at what's happening at this equilibrium. At this equilibrium, if I now make a negative perturbation, the logistic growth is again more than the harvesting. Therefore, it will flow back to this equilibrium. Is that fine? Logistic growth is more than the harvesting mortality. On the other hand, if I make a perturbation to the right, the harvesting mortality is more than the logistic growth. Therefore, overall growth is negative. So therefore, it actually flows back, which means that any perturbation I make to this equilibrium will decay. So this is a stable equilibrium. This is an unstable equilibrium. Is that fine? We still have two equilibrium as before, and the one which has which is slightly less than the carrying capacity now is the stable equilibrium, and this one is unstable. The zero continues to be unstable. Okay, let's now do another scenario when H is very large. The logistic group. Sorry, put it back off again. Let's say H is now very large. What does that mean? That means that, let's say this is a very steep curve now, something like this. So I should have drawn it better. I'll try this again. Oops, sorry. Okay. So now again, look at the two equilibria. One is here, zero. Oh, are there two equilibria at all, by the way? Or do we have only one? How many equilibrium do you have now?
One.
We have only one equilibrium now. Is that stable or not? Let us now again make a perturbation. At this perturbation, however small it is, the harvesting mortality is greater than the logistic growth. So therefore, there is a net negative growth. So therefore, any perturbation I make reduces. Meaning when the harvesting is very high, zero basically becomes a stable equilibrium. And that again makes sense intuitively, right? For small harvesting, we have an equilibrium which is finite population that is stable, but less than the carrying capacity. But when the harvesting is very, very high, zero or the extinction itself becomes a stable equilibrium. Is that fine? So now that we have a qualitative understanding of what's happening, let's now analyze this mathematically. So we will first find the equilibrium by setting the right-hand side to zero. H star. So one equilibrium we can get right away, x star is equal to zero. Or if I take away x star, I have r into 1 minus x star is equal to h. Is that fine? So now we can expand this, okay, and obtain x star to be r minus h divided by r. Is that right? We can also write this as 1 minus h by r. Is algebra correct? Okay. So let us now, we have found two equilibria, 0 and 1 minus h by r. Let us analyze the stability. So what do we need to do? We need to find f prime of x, which is basically d by dx of this function. What is it going to be? We have a linear term now, rx, that would just give me r. Okay, the next is rx squared, that will give us 2rx. This is at x star, by the way. So and then you have minus h. Okay, so f prime of x star is basically r minus h minus 2r x star. Okay, so let us evaluate. What do we get? R minus h. Is it correct? Okay, for x star is equal to 0, stable, we need the condition that f prime x, that means r minus h is less than 0. This means r is less than h. You all agree with this? Now, what does this mean? So what is R and what is H? H is the per capita growth rate when the population size is very small. Do you agree with that? The logistic model, what is the interpretation of R? R basically is the per capita growth rate when the population is very small. And what is H? H is the per capita harvesting rate. So now for the extinction to be stable, you want that per capita growth rate to be less than the harvesting, or rather harvesting is large. Meaning when the harvesting is large, you will have extinction which is unstable, which is stable. So likewise, if you wanted to find the condition for X unstable, it's exactly the opposite. R minus H is greater than zero. That means if the per capita growth rate of the logistic term is more than the harvesting rate, then you know you will have zero to be unstable. Is that all fine so far? Let's do for the other equilibrium now. X star was 1 minus H by R. Now we need to insert this X star in this equation, okay? In this equation, shall we do that? So let's just evaluate this first. R minus H minus 2R. Okay, R minus H over R, is that fine? So this R cancels. So you have R minus H. Okay. So you have R minus H minus 2 times of R minus H. Is that fine? This is nothing but H minus R. Is that correct? Okay, so let's go to the next slide and evaluate what this means. So for X star is equal to 1 minus, for this to be stable, what do we need? We need this to be negative, right? So this negative means H minus R is negative. This means that, does that make sense? If harvesting rate is less than the logistic growth rate, then this will be a stable equilibrium. So note that this number is less than 1. And if this condition is satisfied, what is this number? This will also be positive, right? If H is less than R, this ratio is less than 1. Therefore, X star will be greater than 0. Is everyone fine with this? This means if harvesting is low. So it will, unstable will be exactly opposite criteria, right? If H minus R is greater than zero, meaning H is greater than R, meaning if harvesting is high. So any questions on this? So Pavan,
Vishu, but when we had this exact model, so we tried putting H equal to R, and even then the population went extinct after long time scales. So when it's so I'm trying to understand, like, where does it fit under this? Because if
that's a very good point.
If it's equal, the whatever the size of the fertilizer, the perturbation should stay basically constant. So even when we start with a large enough population to ignore small number artifacts, I wanted to understand how that works.
So what did you find? Your finding was that
when the population went extinct, but after a much longer time scale.
Extinct. Second point was after a very long time. So both of them are really good points, and I want to discuss them, but let's just make sure there are no questions so far. So let's discuss this question once we write down what's the next thing we do once we have all the plot, what is called the bifurcation diagram, right? So once we write down, we'll discuss this question. Is that fine, Pawan?
Sure.
Okay. So far, any questions on this? So let's go forward. So, you know, unfortunately, you know, I really like to do this on a long whiteboard or a blackboard. That way we have all the steps available in one snapshot. But unfortunately, that's not the case. So we have to live with this. Let's go back what we had. So in this page, we had zero, criterion for zero, right? Okay, so zero was stable for, so let's just do one by one. Let's just plot what happens to zero. Let's just then plot what happens to the other equilibrium. And we will do this as a function of the parameter h. So h is the new parameter we have introduced, right? So therefore it makes sense that we plot how the stability changes with that parameter h. Is that fine? So let us try to plot. This is what we would like to plot. This is h, this is x star. So let's see what happens. What should happen when h is equal to zero? H equal to zero means we're back to logistic model. So what's the stable equilibrium then? It's actually one. Is that right? Also, all of us agree with this simple point. Now let's look at what happens to zero equilibrium, and zero is unstable there when h equal to zero, okay? So let's see what happens to the zero equilibrium. So zero equilibrium is stable for h greater than r, and it is unstable for h less than r. So if I were to now basically find out a point called r, value of h is equal to r, something happens here. So if harvesting rate is low, what do you expect? Will the extinction be stable or an unstable equilibrium? It will be unstable equilibrium for small values of harvesting. It becomes stable equilibrium for larger values of harvesting. Is that right? Did I write that correctly? You know, if R is greater than H, it's unstable. Or rather, if H is less than R, it's unstable. If H becomes greater than R, it becomes stable. Is it fine? Low harvesting is zero unstable. High harvesting is zero stable. Is that fine? So that's what we have done for the one equilibrium. What about the next equilibrium? So that equilibrium is 1 minus h by r. Let's just plot this first. When h equal to 0, what is this? This is 1. And this is a linear function of h, right? So, and it becomes 0 when x star is equal to r. No, h is equal to r. So basically, it will look like this. Is it fine? So this is 1 minus h by r. When h equal to 0, it is 1. When h equal to r, it is 0, and it's linear in between. The question is, what is the stability of this now? So let's go up and look. It is stable for h less than r. Meaning, in this range, this is h less than r. This is h greater than r. It is stable, meaning let us draw this with a solid line. And it becomes unstable for h greater than r. So now just think about the following. What happens when h is greater than r? When h is greater than r, this ratio becomes more than 1 and x star becomes negative. Is that even biologically useful for us to think about such an equilibrium? We shouldn't be bothered because it's a negative population density anyway. So let's not even bother what happens after h greater than r. So this is what we have. So what this means is that for the model given by x star is equal to rx into 1 minus x minus h of x, this is how the equilibrium or the bifurcation diagram looks like. Does it make intuitive sense? If we increase the harvest per capita harvesting rate, then you know the stable population size decreases with age, and then we have an extinction stable equilibrium. Is it fine? Now let's go back to Pawan's question. He had 2 points. When H was equal to R, he found that extinction was the final outcome. Does that make sense to you, Pawan, now?
Yeah, but it almost feels like a small number artifact over there. Like it keeps building up, and over long enough time scales, you extinct. That's how I imagine. I don't know if my intuition is right.
What is the small time effect? I didn't get that.
Like no number. Like even though it's in principle not extinction, like the rate is equal, that the number keeps getting smaller and smaller, and at some point it just goes zero. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'm articulating it right.
Uh-huh.
So I'm trying to rationalize the long time scale.
Yeah. Why is it taking very long? So is the first point, is the first question addressed though?
That's clear. The long
so
time
why scale... is it taking very, very long? That's a very good point. And that's something, you know, I will give you an, you know, I'll try to give you an assignment question on. Okay. Basically, you agree that zero is the equilibrium point at R is equal to zero, and it's actually a stable equilibrium point also, right? But it takes a very long time to reach that equilibrium. Now, what do you mean by very long, right? It's not very clear. Okay.
Number of generations, when I go a bit further away, when H is a bit more than R, even a small number, mm-hmm. The extinction happens in like a finite very generation, fast. Like a very, very, very quick point. Like, okay. Whereas the...
Okay. I totally understand what you're saying. Your point is very valid. We now have 8 minutes. So now I don't think I'll have time to discuss, you know, the second model at all. So maybe shall we just discuss the question that you asked? You know, so far we are looking at only equilibrium. Now what you're asking is a different question. How long does it take to reach the equilibrium, right? That's a very, very interesting question. Okay, shall we think about that question? It's a very important question, because it is something one can potentially also measure in a biological system. Okay, so let's try to do that. So let me not worry about the next model, we can cover in the next class. So what happens? So what happens with, let's think of, you know, time to equilibrium. Okay. Okay, now we agree that, you know, let's consider a simple scenario of two equilibrium. When you have two equilibrium, is it possible that both of them are stable? Just intuitively?
No.
So far in your experience, have you ever found a case when, let's go back to this bifurcation diagram. There are two equilibrium here. One is an extinction, one is a finite size, which only one of them is stable, right? So likewise, once you are above this, you have only one equilibrium, and that's the stable one. Okay. And you know, go back to the discrete time logistic model, you'll probably find the same thing again. Okay. So whenever you have two equilibrium, one of them will be stable, other will be unstable. Okay. And then let us say now I make perturbation from stable equilibrium. From a stable equilibrium. What happens after? We know it returns to equilibrium, right? So that's the definition of stable equilibrium. But how much time does it take? Can we talk about how much time does it take to return to equilibrium? Okay, now remember something that we discussed, okay? When we did this analysis, something called a stability analysis. We all remember stability analysis. What did we do? We considered a perturbation. Let's call the delta x. Is that correct? And then what did we do? We wrote an equation for how this perturbation was changing over time. Okay, and then we wrote down an approximate expression for this. Okay, what was the approximate expression? That approximate expression was, you know, let me write it in this fashion, alpha, you know, times delta x. Okay, what is alpha? We found that alpha was basically f prime. Okay. Do you all remember this? No, we sort of, you know, we looked at how the perturbations changes over time. Okay. And then we found that, you know, the perturbations actually follow this equation. Okay, where alpha is nothing but f prime itself. Okay, actually, maybe I think I did not use this specific form. I'll just write in a different way. I think I did not use the negative sign here. And then I wrote, then alpha was f prime of x star itself. Is that right? So when alpha is negative, this becomes an exponential sort of a, you know, growth equation, but with a negative growth rate. Therefore, it decays exponentially. Do you all agree with that? Okay. And this is how we sort of understood. So now, in this equation, what is the biological interpretation of alpha? I don't know if I discussed this. Did I discuss this? What is the... So I think I did discuss this. Now, to do this, go back to the simple, you know, exponential growth model. When you have an equation like this, x star is equal to r times x, what is the interpretation of r? It is the specific growth rate, right? R per capita growth rate, right? And then whenever you have a rate, what is the meaning of 1 divided by the rate? What does that represent?
Time scale.
It represents a time scale, right? So meaning if the growth rate is, specific growth rate is R, inverse of that gives you a time scale. How much time does it take to grow or decay? Okay, that's what this represents. So so you can just take the inverse of the growth rate to get a sense of how long things, if you know, reach equilibrium basically. Okay, so now apply the same rule to here. If alpha is, you know, negative, and we're looking at, you know, equilibrium and how long does it take to reach equilibrium, what is the meaning of 1 over alpha? 1 over alpha, take the modulus of alpha because alpha can be negative. What does this mean? This is the time to equilibrium. Is it correct? All of you agree with this? So if you just take inverse of the f prime of, so f prime of x star was used to calculate stability, right? If you just take the inverse of that, it actually gives you time to equilibrium. That's a very interesting interpretation, right? F prime of x star sounds like a very abstract quantity. It's something about the growth rate. But the inverse of that actually gives you time, how long does it take to reach equilibrium. Okay, now let us calculate this further. Let us now go back to this equation here. So we calculate f prime of x star, right? F prime of x star was r minus h minus 2r x star. Is that fine? So let us go back to that equation. So f prime of x star was r minus h minus 2r x star. Okay. So f prime of, let's do this. Because we are interested in the extinction equilibrium, what would that be? That would be r minus h. And Pawan specifically wanted to understand how long does it take to return to equilibrium. Now, what is that going to be? That's, if we call that tau, that will depend on 1. So this is alpha, right, in our new notation. So going to depend on 1 over modulus of alpha. What will that be? That's 1 minus r minus h. Is that right, Pawan?
Yes. Now it 1 by 0 practically.
You know what happens at r is equal to it? What's happening? Tau basically. Is that right?
Yeah, makes sense.
Meaning it takes a very, very long time. It doesn't necessarily mean infinity, by the way. Very long. To reach. See, this also gives you an intuition, right? You know, exactly when f prime x star becomes zero, right? That's what places. So basically at r is equal to h, this has become zero, right? F prime of x star has become zero, right? And that's when we say the stability has, you know, there is a change in stability, right? Whenever f prime x star is negative, it is stable. If it is positive, it's unstable. F prime x star is equal to zero is when the stability is changing. And that's also precisely when it takes a very long time to reach an equilibrium. And that's precisely what you have also found in your simulations.
And it also makes sense that even if you have a very small away from r minus h, because it's exponential growth or decay.
Exactly.
Even though, even despite being small, it'll quickly blow up to extinction or whatever
whatever the equilibrium is.
Like, because it's exponential.
It doesn't matter how small alpha is, because the growth or decay is always exponential. It will, you know, the moment you're away from zero, it will happen very quickly. But exactly at zero, it just takes a very, very long time. And this phenomenon is also called So this phenomenon has origins in what is called phase transitions in physics. Okay, and this phenomenon also led to a Nobel Prize in 1970s in physics. You can read that up when you have time. Okay.
Have a question. In the previous slide, can you go to the previous slide once? So the perturbation decays exponentially, right? So technically, it'll take an infinite amount of time for the perturbation to reach zero.
Yeah, but tell me what's wrong with it. Approximation. You know, why is there? Do you remember? You have to now go back and think. There's an approximation here.
Oh, okay. Even then, what does it mean when you write 1 by alpha is the time to reach equilibrium?
What do you mean by what do I mean? Sorry, because, I didn't get your question.
Because the equilibrium point is the point from which you perturb. And coming back to that, even after the approximation takes infinite time, right?
Even if it's exponential decay, is it what you mean? Okay. So there's a very easy way to sort of, you know, address that question, you know. So we don't literally mean that the system will come back to equilibrium. Let's say you have, so let's look at this equation. So I am now accounting for an explicit sign here. Alpha is positive, which means I am looking at a stable equilibrium and I have perturbation from stable equilibrium. Is it fine? So what will be the equation for delta x? I made some perturbation at time zero, right? Is that correct? So the perturbation I have made at zero time unit decays exponentially in this fashion. Exactly. Is that right?
Yeah.
So now we have defined tau is equal to 1 over alpha. What does that mean? That means by this time unit, delta x zero has decayed by E. Is that right? So that's about, you know, 60% or so, 66% or so.
Okay, so it's just a 60.
So it's just the, you know, it's a time. System to think about. Okay.
So you don't mean exactly equilibrium, you just mean
deterministic systems, we will never reach equilibrium.
Okay.
Yeah. But you know, it is exactly half-life.
Okay.
Half-life, when you can, you know, basically say, when does delta T xt becomes half of delta x?
That's what I was asking. This is the half-life, right?
Proportional to half-life. This is proportional to half-life.
Okay.
Now let's now do one more calculation, okay, which is actually very interesting. So let us see what really happens when, how do I, so now all of you agree we made an approximation at arriving this. So this is technically true only for alpha non-zero, right? This equation is true only for alpha non-zero. When alpha was zero, then you have to account for more terms in Taylor series. Is that right? Okay, so when technically alpha is equal to zero, this equation is not even correct. Do all of you see that, by the way? So if you remember the derivation from last week, this assumed that alpha was the leading order term is non-zero. Otherwise, that's why I could ignore everything. Now let's look at this model itself that we are looking at, this model, and let's set H is equal to R and see what happens. Okay. At H is equal to R, what happens? So we have the equation, which is Rx into 1 minus X minus. So those who need to leave may feel free to leave. Can watch the videos later on. Okay. So we have this. Let us now set H is equal to R. What do I get? Now I get Rx minus Rx square minus Rx again. Right? What does that mean? The first term cancels. So basically X star is now minus Rx square. Is that right? Now we can do integration of this. This is dx by X square is equal to minus R dt. Okay, so I'm just going to write that equation again, dx by x square is equal to minus r dt. And then I can do integration on both sides. So right hand side will be easy, r times t. What's the left hand side? It's 1 over x, is that right? Let's say I went from some x0 to x of t. Okay. Is there a minus sign here? Yes, there must be a minus sign. Minus sign here. X zero to X of t. So what do I get? We get 1 by X zero minus 1 by X of t is equal to R of t. So can somebody help me simplify this? We can take the two left hand side, and then we have 1 minus x0 rt divided by x0. So therefore x of t is x0 divided by 1 minus x0 rt.
Sir, I think you're missing a minus sign. Can you check that?
Somewhere?
In the first step. Minus
very first step.
Minus rt.
Here.
No.
1
by x minus step. 1 by
x. Is this fine?
The third equation, sir.
From third is fine. This is also fine.
The one
this is minus RT here. Okay. Then this becomes plus then. Plus. Is it fine? This is fine, right? This is fine. This is fine. Is it fine? So now what was X0, by the way? X0 is the... So if when I go back to this equation, I can think of x0, let's say, see in this equation, what is the equilibrium? X equal to 0 again, right? That's the equilibrium. Now let's say x0 is the perturbation I made at time t equal to 0. And I'm looking at how this is decaying. So how is this decaying? You know, if t, imagine t to be a very large number, then I have x0 divided by x0 rt, it's basically 1 over rt. So how is perturbation decaying now? It's basically decaying as a 1 over t, which is a polynomial function.
Hyperbolic.
Right? It's a polynomial function. It's basically t power minus 1. But what was happening in the stable regime case? It was exponential decay. Which is faster, exponential decay or a polynomial decay?
In long time scales, exponential.
Exponential decay is always faster, right? This is actually a very slow decay. So it is not that there is no decay, by the way. There is decay, as you are seeing. But it's a very slow decay. And this is also called the critical slowing down, as I mentioned. Okay. So I think we can stop here today. And we'll resume in the next class. So I think Friday is a holiday. So we will meet next Wednesday. Is Friday a holiday, by the way? Is it official IAC holiday? So I will check. I'll check and confirm. If it's a holiday, there will be no lab on Friday. Okay. Okay. See you, everyone. If anybody has questions, you can stop and ask me. But I know others, of course, are welcome to me.
Next analysis for the second order terms, or even the first order term becomes zero, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's why you figure out its polynomial time, because
exactly, okay. Because the Taylor series approximation we made
won't hold when the first term is zero. Then this
all the bifurcation points.
All right, okay.
So wherever f prime of x star is zero, this issue happens.
Okay. Are there hypothetically points where f dash is zero and f double dash is zero? I mean, there could be like, you know.
Then you need to have additional. Yeah, it's possible. In principle, it's possible. Yes.
Okay. Fine. And so those would be even slower, I guess.
Even slower. Yes. Absolutely.
Okay.
Vishu, is this phenomenon ever used for damping? Like, I am imagining like a pendulum or something like. Is this metaphorically the same structure? Like, if you find
so damping is not this. Damping is not this. Damping is a like different.
Okay. No, I mean critical damping. Like, is it similar to critical damping, or these are two unrelated terms with just the same critical word?
I have to look up. I have been a long time since I looked up the exact pendulum equation, but use similar terms or very different things in physics and mathematics. So I can look that up. So I think critical damping is where you switch from an oscillatory damping to an overdamped system.
Yeah, from underdamping to overdamping.
Maybe that is not critical. I don't think maybe it is not.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, thanks.
Sir, I had a doubt regarding the course evaluation. So a few days back, we got an email that the marking scheme has changed. There was something like assignment is 0.0%. Is it a mistake that will be 40%, or there will be a mid same that is 40%?
Where does it say, sorry?
I don't know. I could not find it in the canvas, but I got the mail from canvas, but I could not find that particular thing in canvas.
So nothing has changed. So you know there might be minor changes, as I have always said. So you have homework 30%, lab assignment 30, and the 20 plus 20 midterm and final exam. But you know, maybe we can reduce the midterm plus final together to 30%. But I haven't said any information about that though.
Okay, fine. And also,
so I think no. I think what has happened is that there's a new labeling that one of the TAs has done. So earlier, I think I see assignments are weighed by the group. Okay. There's some funny thing here. Yeah, I see what you're confused about. So there is something called an assignment, lab assignment, and homework, right? There are three categories that's listed in the canvas.
Yes, yes.
Somewhere automatically, but that assignment thing doesn't exist. So don't worry.
Okay.
You only have a lab assignment and a homework.
And also I'm
using different words to in order to confuse the lab assignment and the homework.
Okay. And also if there is a midterm, then when that will happen, or
I will make sure everybody is available in this app.
Okay, fine.
Okay.
Is it around anytime in April or later?
Today is end of March. Certainly it can't be in March. So maybe in April, yes.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, it will be a very short one. Huh? Or I may even cancel the midterm entirely.
Okay.
But I think, it might be useful to sort of just for everyone to know where they stand, what they don't understand. Sometimes you think you understand, but only when you write an exam, you will understand what you don't understand, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So from that point of view, it might be helpful, but with a very small weightage.
Okay, fine. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah.